96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Lauren McCartney is brought to you in part by Burger King, Commonwealth Bank, J.S. Johnson, Neptune Compostables, Fidelity Bank, and Wendy's.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to the Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name's Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. All right, we didn't get a chance yesterday to talk about the Prime Minister's mid-year budget statement, which was terrible. Let's just start off there. It was terrible. It was lacking. It was wanting. It was really bizarre. He addressed nothing that needed to be addressed. He announced the housing thing, which is disproportionate and discriminatory. Happy for those who will somehow get selected, whether it's a lottery system or not. He announced a real property tax thing, which is going to benefit those who have money to pay and will screw over most of the people who don't have the money to pay. If someone had waited 7 years not to pay their real property tax, they win. He had no plan for the economy. He says that next term he's going to focus on the poor and land and housing. So just what the hell have you been focusing on this term remains to be seen. Further to that, you're going to wait till next term to focus on lands? Refresh my memory as to whose office lands falls under. You didn't take a portfolio. It says the best thing ever happened, right? We're in deep trouble, right? Lands is already under your office. The office of the Prime Minister is directly responsible for lands. That's A. B, you have a Minister of Youth already. C, you have to focus on the poor as well as everyone else. Contrary to popular opinion, the Bahamas is not solely populated by poor people. There are a lot of hurting people, a lot of poor people, but you got to govern the country as a whole. And Desmond Bannister is going to be your co-prime minister. That's what we got from the Minister of Finance on Monday. Let me explain to you the depth of this situation. And we're going to talk about some things as well. We are now in a situation, and I'm dead serious about this. We are now in a situation where our debt to GDP ratio is hitting 85% this year. We're in a situation where we're running a $1.3 billion deficit, and that's going to increase, right? That's going to go up. We're in a situation where 4 years ago, and we told you, everyone said, hey, don't do that, playa. The government borrowed $750 million. I'm going to help you to understand the depth of this situation. So when you see your Minister of Finance up there cracking jokes and spouting nonsense and all this, and you can understand how screwed we are and why it's a problem, why we need serious, serious intervention. We are in a situation where I'll just give you one example. We borrowed $750 million from the U.S. market in 2017. We borrowed it at a rate of 6%, higher than U.S. Treasury bond yields at the time, and we borrowed it on a 10-year term. Stay with me. I just want you to do a little basic math for you to understand where we are. 10 years, $750 million, 6%. So we've been paying on the $750 million. I don't know if they're paying biannually or what, but let's just do some quick math, right? On $750 million, we've been paying $45 million a year just on interest on that bond. They say some of it was used to retire old debt. Fine, whatever. We've been paying $45 million a year in interest on just that bond. This loan is due beginning in 2027. The principal has to be repaid in three equal installments. So that's $250 million per year for 3 years beginning in 2027. So over the lifetime of this loan, we would have paid out $450 million in interest. Yes? Come 2027, you're going to have to come up with $250 million in cash to make the first repayment installment. All right? That's almost the education budget. Come 2026, I apologize. You're going to have to come up with the first thing, I believe it is. That's $250 million in cash you're going to need in 2026. Just for that. We ain't talking about the $600 million that we borrowed in October or the $200 plus million dollars we borrowed in December. But let's just stick with the $750 because that's coming up soon. So in 5 years, you're going to have to come up with $250 million cash to make the first payment on that. The next year, you're going to have to come up with another $250 million cash to make the second payment. And the third year, you're going to have to make another payment of $250 million cash. When you took out the loan, you said, don't worry, man. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to establish a sinking fund. Now, a sinking fund is a fund you set up where you set aside a certain amount of money and you go, this is to repay the principal on this loan when it's due. So I'm going to set aside every year, over 10 years, right, about $75 million. That's the theory you're operating off. I'm going to set aside about $60, $75 million in a sinking fund. So when come time to pay this loan, I ain't caught out here. Can't find the money. Got to go borrow to pay off this other loan. So they put money in the sinking fund in the first year. Glorious. Yes? Then they put money in the sinking fund in the second year. Lovely. Yes? Now, what happened to the sinking fund this year? They said, and here's why everyone told you not to do it. They said that because revenue collection is down, some $425 million from the same six-month period the previous year, and down beyond what you had projected you would have collected. They have yet to hit any projection, by the way. Yes, it's just a projection, but you could come in the ballpark at least. Something should inform it. I could project anything. You said because revenue collection is down so much, you're not going to put any money in the sinking fund this year. You have right now $190 million in your sinking fund. So you are about $560 million short to pay that loan back beginning 5 years from now. In order to make up this money, since you're not doing it this year, you're going to have to set aside in your sinking fund over $100 million a year just to pay back that loan. Again, we did another $600 million in U.S. bonds. We did another $250 in U.S. bonds, and we've done a few others too. We did a CDB one. We did some IDB ones on more favorable terms. The $600 million, you're going to be paying back at 8.95%. The $250 million, you're going to be paying back at 8.25%. We have a situation where our tourism inflows have been badly damaged, and we don't know how we're going to recoup those losses. We have a situation where we have to continue borrowing at greater rates, and yet we are still subsidizing the Water and Sewage Corporation. We are still subsidizing. I'm going to leave that mess alone. We're still subsidizing capital projects. We're still subsidizing very heavily healthcare, education. We still got to pay for police. We still got to pay for the defense force. But yet we have Mr. Finance who gets up in the House of Assembly during the worst economic time that this country has seen since the Great Depression, and he outlines nothing about how we get out of this except wait and see. You claim we're going to have 5% economic growth this year. How? You claim we're going to have 5%, almost 4.8% economic growth next year. How? How's the economy going to grow? By the couple of arena projects you said that you guys are fast-tracking, that you didn't explain the economic impact of, that you didn't explain where we're going to go with that? We've got to get serious here. We have revenue collection down hundreds of millions of dollars. We're borrowing at exorbitant rates, and we have no choice but to borrow at this stage. But we have not heard a conclusive plan about how they're going to right side this deficit spending. And all it is jokes and giggles and fun and laughter. We are in a serious problem with a man who is unserious about these things at the helm. The loans that we undertook, and again, you got to borrow. The loans that we undertook, we had to pay $50 million in finance charges. Sit down and listen to what I'm saying to you. We paid $50 million in finance charges for the loans we just undertook. We were in a dire, dire situation. We have yet to hear a plan for economic growth. Or maybe I'm missing something. I read the entire speech and I listened to him. I listened back to what he said. Yet you're standing up there and you're giving out election talk about houses, lots in Killarney, and you're going to go figure out where it is on other islands. We have major problems. You didn't explain how we're going to utilize public-private partnerships to better our situation. And everyone expects me to sit here and take this man seriously. We have major financial problems. We're going to have a BPL rate reduction bond coming up shortly. It's going to add 15% to utility bills. How do you square that with GDP growth? How does the GDP grow? How do you right side this equation? How do you balance this all out? These are very serious, challenging, trying times that the Bahamas are in. And we really need a Minister of Finance who's going to take this seriously. This is very serious business. You have to level with the Bahamian people about the depth of these challenges that we are now facing, and that there's no sunny side of this in the near term. This is going to get rocky. We can expect more downgrades. We can expect borrowing at higher prices. And we can expect, if things don't turn around in the next 18 months, to have a real balance of payments problem. Meaning that we're going to have to get seriously creative about meeting our commitments. And everything ain't just going to go where it is. And I wish we just had someone who could explain the depth of that to everybody so everybody could stop kiki-kiing around here like it's all good. This is a problem that requires competency that is just not there in the Minister of Finance. Now, you may say, oh, you don't like me. Fine. I mean, I don't care. I don't like it. I don't like his prime ministership. That's for certain. But at least with Peter Turnquest, strategy I disagree with wholeheartedly, but at least with Peter Turnquest, I knew there was someone there who understood the depth of these challenges. And when you sit up there and you start talking crazy about what you're going to do next term, which is mad presumptuous, by the way, and is a long shot, by the way, you start scaring me now. I'm frightened now. Because I live in this economy too. Contrary to popular opinion, I'm not rich. I don't sit on a nest egg. I'm not a trust fund baby. This is going to impact all of us. We really need someone at the helm going to deal with this in a sensible, proper manner. So I had to talk about the presentation by the Minister of Finance in the House of Assembly on Monday. It was worrisome. Now, we can talk about some other things, too, but I wanted to illustrate to you the depth of our challenges that are ahead of us. This isn't a game where Desmond Bannister and you're going to be co-prime minister and you're going to be best friends forever. It's nonsense. Speak to us about the gravity of what's happening and explain to us your strategic plan to get us out of here. Or admit that you don't have one. You keep giving the prime minister passes for his failures in leadership. But as Minister of Finance, we don't have the luxury for you to not take this seriously. We'll go to the text messages. This is one, you're depressing me, man. Oh, and don't forget, in December 20, our U.S. reserves were $1.7 billion. Then in February 21, after a $750 million borrowing bond at 8.9%, our reserves went to 2.7. How? That's a debt, not a reserve. And it's so silly to say that, oh, the dollar's the strongest it's ever been, the most stable it's ever been. What does that even mean? It's strong because you borrowed a bunch of U.S. currency, and the only reason the U.S. currency is still sitting there is because the tourists ain't come back yet. Because as soon as the tourists come back and the economy picks back up, we import everything. We import everything, right? You're sitting there and you're talking about Picewell during the bloody budget communication. You need to worry about your own issues you got going on. A, B, worry about the country. Picewell and South Andros will be just fine. I'm sure that won't change the situation we're facing. Who the PLP runs in South Andros. Not that I'm interested in y'all business. But that's got nothing to do with the mid-year budget and where we are. And the other MPs who are running out about it in the House, grasp what is happening. We are in trouble. You need to start strategically thinking about how we get out of this trouble. This says, if the government says they'll focus on the poor in the next term, then who is the focus in the current term? Very sobering. We have a problem, all right? And I really wanted to get into it on Monday, but he wasn't finished his presentation, and then we had Money Pendling on yesterday, and that was interesting. But this is serious stuff. We're not going to continue. We're not going to be able to, and I'm serious about this. We are not going to be able to continue to keep everyone, and call me reckless, and I challenge the Minister of Finance to come sit in this chair in front of me and say I lie and I'm reckless when I say this, and show me how you get out of it. We're not going to be able to continue to keep everyone in the civil service employed at this rate. We're not going to be able to continue to contribute to everyone in the civil services who is permanent, pensionable, and whatever the other term is. We're not going to be able to fully contribute to their pensions at this rate. We are not going to be able to continue providing the level of service, whatever you think of it, that the government of the Bahamas provides to the public at this rate. This is a frightening scenario. And just praying that the tourists come back isn't good enough. I too pray they come back. I pray to God that they come back. I want to see you. Come on the beach with your drunken self. Please come into restaurants, do all that. Come play golf. Come, please. Eat up the kunk. I want your jet ski, all this. Walk around in hardly no clothing, whatever. But we don't have the luxury of having a minister of finance who is not focused on this day in and day out. You're scaring me now when I hear you say stupid stuff about you and Desmond Bannister. How you're going to be friends and how it works so well when they're friends. What are you talking about? Do you understand where this country is the position that we are now in? Level with the Bahamian people. Explain to them that this is going to take a concerted, surgical effort in order to get through this. And find someone who can dedicate themselves to this seriously to be your Minister of Finance. Because you clearly are not focused. This says, thanks so much, Juan. Someone at 96.9 had to raise the alarm. Economy-wise, you've definitely carved out for yourself the makings of a great journalist. Well, thank you. But this stuff is scary stuff. If you look at the actual mid-year budget, beyond what he yakking about in the House, if you juxtapose the two, you would see that he's not taking this seriously. This is a serious problem that we are facing. And no, it's not your fault. You didn't create the pandemic. I'm tired of hearing you run on about the hurricanes because hurricanes have happened in every administration as far as I'm concerned. Dorian was a big one. But it wasn't like we were unfamiliar with hurricanes before. But there were choices you made and decisions you made that have us in a more precarious position than we would have already been in. Case in point, this $750 million loan that's going to come due. Some of y'all are going to be dead. No offense, by the time that it comes due, your children are going to suffer for this if we don't navigate this carefully. My children. You the one who raised the VAT. We go lose the country. Okay, player. What now? You did these things that made what's coming going to be that much more painful. Now you should explain how we get out of it in all seriousness. And that you can't, that you stand up there and you can't do that, and you're having a mid-year budget debate when last year you had none, although I think you should certainly have one this year, because of the seriousness of the situation. We have major challenges. Y'all got to stay focused. Right? I, too, enjoy the petty. I ain't above nothing. Right? I don't sit here and go, oh, I only, watch the PBS News Hour. No, dude, I watch, what is it, Greenleaf? Bridgerton? You ever watch Bridgerton? My wife had me watching that. By the way, maybe I'm getting old, right? Does everything have to be about people juicing, like, through the entire series? Do I have to watch your entire act of copulation from beginning to end throughout several episodes? Is that necessary? I know I'm not letting my children watch it, but me personally, I'm like, is this advancing the story, me watching you guys juice each other? Is there a narrative purpose to this? Anyway, I digress. I'm not Mr. Oh, I only read the Iliad. I read comic books. You know what I mean? But at some point, somebody's got to get serious. This says, morning for starters, let's cut all the PM and XPM, ex-MP's pension, and then cut the civil servants down. Y'all think this is a joke? He says, I found your AirPods in my gal Honda last night. You hit for not me. One good day, two straight. I know about that. You better. It ain't looking too straight right now. I can be real with you. So when I see when this cramp hits you, when the cramp come, I know about two straight. This gonna hurt. I ain't gonna lie to you. This gonna hurt. And if you scared, then move out the way. Right? That's like in the gym. You get scared. You see the weight there, geez, I. So step aside, man. Let somebody else push this weight. If you're scared, if it's too heavy for you. Says, don't the Pinlings have enough, or is now time for the next generation to get on the entitlement cash cow gravy train while countless people suffer and are forgotten? I don't know about your logic. I don't know what the cash cow gravy train is. Last I checked, Pinlings were doing just fine. They don't need to get into office to have anything. Last I checked. Good afternoon, McCartney. I need my land now. I applied from 2002, so what should I do so I can get my project started? If granted, now I can make headway with the project. Well, he's going to focus on land next term. So, you know, best you wait on that. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hello, good afternoon.
About the day, you don't waste so long with you, Juan.
Hey, what's happening, brother?
I'm right here, thank God. Juan.
Yes?
On what rate the government had borrowed that last set of money in which they had borrowed when it came to the hurricane and the buying of those machines for BPL? And what they put up for collateral?
Okay, those are two things that are unconnected that need to be discussed separately, and I'll try to do it quickly. After the hurricane, I'm not sure about the rate they borrowed at. There was a lot of local borrowing, and there was some foreign borrowing. I'd have to research that.
Okay.
The BPL engines were bought with money that was borrowed by BPL using BPL as its own collateral and credit backing facility. And I don't know the rate at which they borrowed that money, but they borrowed the money to do maintenance. You see how the transmission and distribution thing has fallen apart? And on a family honesty, that's what they borrowed the money for. But they took that money instead after the fire, according to Donovan Moxie, and bought the Wärtsilä engines at a cost of, I believe, $130 million, off the top of my head.
And how long do they have to pay it back?
I'm not certain.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. This is, hold on, time out. You say BPL bill going up. Juan, I hope I just hear you say that. If you did again, please repeat what you said. Did you miss the entire show where I had Donovan Moxie here and he explained that the rate is going to go up by 15%? Which maybe it won't be as painful, but I think for a lot of businesses it will be. But maybe it won't be as painful because the fuel charge has gone down so much because they did the hedging. But the hedging still cost us $1 million. By us, I mean the government, BPL. But your BPL bill is going to go up by 15%. This says, I told my family this budget was crazy, and they said I was being political. I mean, I don't. If you read, how could anyone? If you read the document, okay? I don't play games, right? You put a document in front of me, I'm going to read it because I don't take you seriously. First, TurnQuest, I took much more seriously, but even with him, I would read the documents and look at the rationale behind what's going on. And the budget's got a problem. It's a problem, and I don't believe your projections are going to be accurate. I don't believe you're going to come in where you say you're going to come in. You yourself admit in your fiscal strategy report, in your budget, mid-year budget communication, that the economy was hurt. I'm sorry, let me put it properly how you did say it. I don't want you to say I lie on you. You yourself said revenue collection was impacted by the second wave and the restrictions put in place to curb it. Yes? You who come and clown and take credit for how good we are and we're the envy of the Caribbean, are we? Your restrictions, your policies impacted revenue collection. You got to be real about that. You have a fiscal strategy report that says we're going to get back down to a 50% debt to GDP ratio in 2030. How? What are you talking about? You have a fiscal strategy report that says we're going to get to 0.5% GFS deficit spending by 2025. How? Through what mechanism? By just shifting numbers around like ever you be serious. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, well, what's up, my brother?
Hey, I'm good, buddy. How's it going?
All is well. I wonder what they can call you today. I guess they can call you PLP today.
I don't even care, buddy. I might as well tell you. Because
let me
stop you 1 second, DeWitt. I can let you talk, right? DeWitt,
hey.
What I just explained to you, whoever is a PLP, whoever is a FNM, whoever is a DNA, whoever is a kingdom government, gonna have to pay that back, them and
that's
their
right.
children.
You ain't lying with that, bro.
Okay, so call me whatever
it,
you want.
The reality of it, Papa, it's straight up. Mind me, whether at times people might, you might ruffle the PLP or the FNM or whoever the DNA, whoever they is. But once you being real, bro, stick to you being real. That's what counts. But I want to say something to you. I want to draw something to your attention, what was brought to my attention. I asked someone in finance, not someone who, people who the movers and shakers, someone who I consider to be a mover and shaker of this country when it comes to our finances. So I asked the person, I said that, what options do we have, does the prime minister has left on the table for this country before he decides to call in his general election? So the person said to me that they can say three options that they can see for now. Either he calls a general election, either he raises VAT, or either he does a massive downsizing in the government department. And Mr. McCartney, to be honest with you, listening to what you're saying and listening to the budget and reading part of the budget, we seriously behaving people. This ain't about politics, What the brother trying to explain to y'all got to understand, it ain't us. We born you in your 40s, I in my 50s. We have God, God have us here for only a certain time. It's for your children, your grandchildren who got to pay these things back. And nothing to say at the end of the tunnel to say, well, hey, to see some sort of light. We're just going into depths and depths and depths, Mr. McCartney. And if the people don't understand what you're trying to explain today, if y'all taking it to be political, how some of y'all go sometimes, well, I think y'all need to go look in the mirror. But Vaughn, keep it up, bro. Keep it up.
Thank you, my brother. You see, the only place the politics comes in, and I've stopped living in la-la land where I expect politicians not to be political. All right? I stopped it. I get it. You're going to use the mid-year budget debate to attack the PLP. The PLP is going to use the mid-year budget debate to attack the FNM on a party level, right? Beyond an administrative level. I get it. But at some point, the substance has to be about addressing the issues that are before us, not just platitudes to try to make us feel better. This is a problem. And you need to present a proper strategy on how to get us out of it, and that y'all haven't sat down and thought this thing through at this point since last March, to the point where you understand some things are going to have to shift and you're going to have these difficult conversations with these people. Because wishing it'll go away is not going to help. We got to take a break. We'll be right back.
Tired of disposable plates that fall apart and leave the food in your lap? Neptune Compostables can solve your problem. Toss your food in our heavy-duty clamshells.
At Neptune, we supply heavy-duty take-out plates, coffee cups, sauce cups, soup bowls, straws, and plastic-free take-out bags. We offer free delivery to offices, takeaways, restaurants, bars, and households.
And we ship to the family islands.
Order now via WhatsApp at 816-2442. That's 816-2442. Or shop online at NeptuneCompostables.com.
Neptune, where your sense makes sense.
You asked for it, and now it's here. Introducing the all-new new plant-based Rebel Whopper only at Burger King NASA. The new Rebel Whopper is everything you expect in a Whopper with a meatless plant-based patty that is flame-grilled to perfection with all the fixings you love on that famous sesame seed bun. Come try out the new Rebel Whopper with fries and a Pepsi and see if you can tell the difference. The Rebel Whopper is 100% Whopper, 0% beef, and only at Burger King NASA, where taste is king.
Hello, sir. Your credit card bill is due. Hello, sir. It's time for your monthly loan payment. Tired of creditors pounding at your door? Sign up for a debt consolidation loan from Fidelity Bank and consolidate your debt into one low monthly payment. What's more, you'll also earn interest on a built-in savings account. The pandemic has curbed many freedoms, but at Fidelity, our focus is to help regain your financial freedom. Visit a branch or speak to Fidelity Bank at 356-7764. COVID safety measures in place at all branches. Fidelity, we're good for you.
This is Guardian Radio, 98.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. My name's Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. And look, I don't want to hear it, right? I don't want to hear it. Oh, Juan, you don't like me. Look, whatever, okay? I don't think he's a good prime minister. I'm certain he's not a good minister of finance. The point is this. He's the prime minister. He's the minister of finance. You got to help get us out of this. There's a debt burden that is being saddled on the country that is unfortunate. And much of it necessary. Some of it didn't have to be like this. But you now have to lead. Unprecedented times call for unprecedented leadership. Who did I hear say that? Belinda Wilson. I'm stealing your thing, Belinda Wilson. I don't know if you stole it. Unprecedented times call for unprecedented leadership. And this is not it. Says, boy, Juan, sounds like y'all in real trouble. Not me, though. I'm moving somewhere north. It says, we owe all of this, and our government refuses to introduce a progressive tax that will destroy the country to protect the wealthy. We're so lost, Juan. The FNM screwed up so bad, they don't want to win. The PM will pack up and leave after he destroys our country. He ain't going nowhere. He gonna be all right. It says, Juan, do you know if a portion of the civil servant's salary goes toward their pension or is it all government funded? It's all government funded, and that's my point. At this point, right, and it's enough people who could be working on this, at this point, you need to say, look, you got to restructure some of these debts you have. Some of the debt you have needs to be restructured. Some of the way you accumulate this debt, some of your expenditure needs to be restructured. The IMF done tell you that 50 times. Nah, I ain't saying, listen, now, everything the IMF say, because the IMF don't live here. But you're going to have to get serious about some of this stuff. Dead serious. Beyond the bloody election. So put your money where your mouth is. You said you would rather lose an election and lose the country. But that's not how you're acting with this. Everything's not okay. This requires constant 24-hour almost focus. You could sleep and eat and use the bathroom. But this requires focus. What we need to do is have the discussion with the civil servants, and they're hardworking. Many of them are dedicated. You got some, you know, fat you could trim, but have the discussion with them that we are not in the same position as we were 30 years ago, 40 years ago, 5 years ago. We're going to have to change the laws to restructure, and the unions could like it or not. You're going to have to wake up and realize what's happening. We are going to have to restructure the way we do emoluments, right? The way we pay out all these gratuities, the way we do pension and all that. We're going to have to change it. It can't be the way it was. And yes, that may mean a little extra hardship for you, but we will still at least have a job. You'll still at least have a job. All right, we can no longer afford the built-in. We'll try to help with some of the cost of living stuff, but we can no longer afford these built-in increases in the contracts. It's just not there. When things are different, yes. But to act as if things can continue the same way when you have your revenue drying up makes no sense. A government is not a house. It's not a household budget. But in terms that anyone could understand, if you have lost income, but you still have the capacity to borrow and borrow at exorbitant rates, you start to cut certain things. Not things like capital expenditure that could create income and boost the economy. You know, I believe in a countercyclical spending, but not everyone does. Fair enough. You know, there are things you can do to boost the economy that you can get creative with doing. You want to unleash Crown Land? Fine. Do it in a way that creates broad economic stimulus. Not just welcome to Killarney. What are you talking about? What is it that you're talking about? A better idea would be to utilize the Crown Land. Let people apply for it. You cannot sell it or transfer it within a certain period of time, but you could go to the bank and you can get started on building, on servicing the lots. Stimulate the economy with jobs, construction, have a housing initiative. You got to start thinking big now. You got to do things on a micro and a macro level to start stimulating this economy to make it sure that people have more work, more money, more income. Yes, for the tourists to return. But until then, let's make sure that we're trying to do all we can. Not just in the house. What are you doing? This is serious business. If I went to my accountant, if I have a company, and I go to my accountant, my chief financial officer, and we're bleeding money, and I ask you what you're going to do, oh, well, you know, next time me and this one going to be co-chief financial officer, what the hell are you talking about? What are you talking about? We have record debt. We have a record deficit. We have record unemployment. What is it you are talking about? Explain to me how we navigate this situation, and what is the least painful way that we emerge from this. Could you please ask NIB if we'd be paid the remainder of $140 of the unemployment assistance when we only paid $60 a few weeks ago? I can't. I don't know anything about that. Oh, we got break for news. Let's break for news. We'll be back on the other side.
Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. You're listening to the 1 o'clock report over the Guardian News Network. I'm Jillian Gray. Thanks so much for tuning in. Topping news, shouting, PM got to go, and holding picket signs with various sayings like, no more slapping up menace, unnecessary lockdowns cause Bahamians, and no more sleeping in cars. Members of the DNA party marched downtown demanding that the Prime Minister ring the bell for election.
We have come to ask the Honorable Dr. Hubert Alexander Menace to ring the bell. For almost 365 days, we've been under emergency orders, and the poor decisions by the Prime Minister have cost jobs. It has cost lives. It has cost livelihoods. And we are calling on the Prime Minister to free us from this misery.
DNA leader Arinthia Komolafe said they decided to take to the streets to represent the concerns of Bahamians. Some of those concerns, she said, stems from the hardships caused because of COVID-19 orders.
The travel of cost of travel to family islands is too expensive. Yes. Bahamians cannot move back and forth. Yes. It costs $100 plus just to take an RT-PCR test to go to see our family members on the island at a time when the cost of living is so high. 12% fund. Food is high. Rent is high. Electricity is high. And Bahamians can't afford to go home. We're asking Dr. Pharaoh Menes to let our people go.
They weren't alone in Rawson Square as taxicab drivers too aired their frustration outside Parliament. Taxicab drivers say they are still fighting for new taxi plates to be issued and for the color of taxicab plates to be different from that of SDs.
I will inform taxi drivers and instruct them not to re-elect this government. Okay? I will instruct them not to do that. Now, they can do what they feel like doing because I can't control them once again. But the whole point is, we are 1125 strong. We have family members and we have influence in other unions. So we will garnish together with other unions and we will come out here in full force and we will persuade our people. We will basically instruct them not to vote for this government because they mean us no good.
Meantime, inside the House of Assembly, Minister of National Security Marvin Dame said there have been 18 dash cams installed in police vehicles to date. Nearly 4,000 recordings have been made. At least two of those recordings have been requested for review.
Of the amount, one request was made for footage to aid in a police complaint and one request to aid in a police investigation. These investments are worth every single dollar, as they bring about a greater degree of accountability, improve the transparency of the police force, and it mitigates against any complaints against police officers, and bring those officers who are acting contrary to policies and the law to the forefront and to justice.
Dame said investments in technology is paramount. The government procured 200 body-worn cams and 200 dash cams, which went live in August of 2020. Dame said more than half of those body cams are in use.
120 body-worn cameras have been deployed in operational command and 20 at the Cable Beach Police Station. The remaining 80 are being upgraded with the necessary specs while officer training is ongoing. And these technologies are being supported, Mr. Speaker, by policy that governs this use.
The National Security Minister also heralded low crime figures, saying during the last 4 years, crime has been on a downward trend. He chalked that downward trend up to good governing policies and the strategies executed by law enforcement.
I trust. It also means that our four-pronged approach of conceptual leadership, technical investment in technology, complemented by professional development to support the scene and good governance, undergirded with fiscal responsibility and integrity, are indeed working. There are those on the side opposite who continue to speculate and provide their own unsubstantiated commentary with no empirical basis as to why crime under our administration continues to trend downward. But the good thing, Mr. Speaker, is this. It continues to trend downward.
While Monique Pinling is trying to put an end to speculation, she and her family were somehow responsible for Piswell Forbes' decision not to seek renomination. He is currently MP of the area she would like to represent, but she insists his decision had nothing to do with her interest in running. Georgie O'Bain has that.
Following an announcement that Mangrove Key and South Andros MP Piswell Forbes will not be running in the next general election, Monique Pinling, daughter of the late Sir Lyndon Pinling, says the announcement was interesting but not surprising.
Very shocked and surprised, disappointed as well, because as far as I was, what was said was that the incumbent was entrenched and that he was saved because he... survived the last election, and they felt that he had survived that he should be given another chance. So to hear that he had resigned was interesting, but not a surprise.
Pinglin, who previously announced her intention to run for the seat, insists that Forbes' decision had nothing to do with her or her family.
So it had nothing to do with myself or my family. If everybody just think it through. The party leadership had told me that they didn't want me on the ticket, and that was sometime last year. And from since then, I haven't been back to Andros. I haven't campaigned. I have been in touch with the people, and that's primarily because of COVID. I couldn't travel, but I haven't even been around to headquarters. We haven't been speaking. We haven't spoken to anybody from leadership since our last encounter.
According to Pinlan, she hasn't spoken to the leadership of the PLP since they revealed to her that having a Pinlan on the ticket may affect the party's chance of winning the next general election, a reason that she wholeheartedly disagrees with.
They said that they just didn't want a Pinlan on the ticket, and that whatever, because it was political season and campaign season, that they thought that the government or would use Daddy's or my dad's commission of inquiries, drug years, crime years, as leverage and tool to win the general election.
Party leader Philip Davis dismissed Pinlan's claims.
Those are unfortunate comments because we, the Progressive Party, do not accept any negative connotations that's been out there up with Sir Lyndon. We revere him as the father of the nation. So why would we want to not honor him? And it is the Progressive Party who continues to this day to defend that legacy.
Reporting for the Guardian News Network, I'm Georgie O'Bain.
And MP and Parliamentary Secretary Pakisha Parker Edgecombe has now been promoted to a cabinet post. The cabinet office announced yesterday she is to take Iram Lewis's place as Minister for State for Disaster Preparedness, Management and Reconstruction in the office of the Prime Minister. Her appointment will take effect from the moment she takes the oath of office. She now becomes the only woman in cabinet following the resignation of Lanisha Roll. Parker Edgecombe said she was humbled by the appointment and was looking forward to working with the established team to carry out the government's mandate. Well, PLP Chairman Fred Mitchell this morning criticized the appointment, though, saying Parker Edgecombe will now be paid more for essentially doing nothing. He also hit out at the Prime Minister for wasting public funds by creating a job just to stave off criticism over the absence of women in cabinet. You were listening to the 1 o'clock report over the Guardian News Network. I'm Jillian Gray on behalf of our entire news team. Thanks so much for joining us.
Beulah Gal, can you believe this? We are now the patrol queens of the neighborhood.
We now large and in charge. So we need to check out what's going on in everybody yard. What about that gun that we know that Junior and his homeboys just ran out? Can we report that too?
Of course we can.
But we could be in deep trouble if they find out.
We need to report what we see, Beulah. When you call Crime Stoppers, they just answer your call in Miami.
So then we can report everything? Guns? Where they hiding the drugs? Who shoot who? Who part of which gang? Or who disturbing the peace with the loud music and the motorcycles?
Then our neighborhood will be the best in the Bahamas. And everybody gonna want to come live here. And then our house price will go up, gal.
So what we waiting on? What's the number?
If you see something, say something. Let us all pitch in and stop the crime before it's your time. Call 328-8477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands. Or text us through the Crack Crime Bahamas app. Stop the crime before it's your time.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day. We'll be right back.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. We're talking mid-year budget. We're talking fiscal strategy report. Beyond, I think more important than the actual state of the budget, which is important, but it is what it is at this point because we're kind of backed into a corner, is the strategy on how to get us to the other side. Now, let's say for a second, and I'll get to your text. Let's say for a second that vaccinations speed up. They're speeding up now already. And Dwayne Sand said it may take 7 years to vaccinate everybody. I doubt that because there are going to be more productions going to ramp up and it's going to happen. So let's say by the end of this year, the majority of people in North America have been vaccinated. Europe have been vaccinated. Those are our chief markets. North America, really, mainly. And the majority of people in the Bahamas have been vaccinated. I will take the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. I'll go on TV and do it for, if you want me to. But I'm fine taking the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. And we've reached herd immunity, and borders open up. Tourists come back. We have the restrictions are lifted, and things are back to normal. The revenue's flowing in. Everybody's gaming again, like usual. Jobs are back already. And in that scenario, sure, there's growth. I don't know about 5%, but okay. But considering how deeply we contracted, a return to normal would see a rapid rate of growth. Okay, and so let's just say things are back to normal, right? And deficits are beginning to come under better control, and we're no longer in this billion-plus territory. The fact remains, though, and it's going to feel good. Right, when you're looking at it, you go, oh, well, things are good. Right? Because I believe the economy, once this thing is over, the world economy will come roaring back because there's a lot of pent-up demand and people are ready to get back in action. The fact remains, you're still going to have a serious debt problem. All right? And that's where trouble starts, right? Or trouble continues. Like trouble, the house is on fire, so to speak, when no tourists are coming and you got the revenue ain't coming in and you got to borrow. But let's say you get that under control and the tourists come back, you're still going to have to deal with all that you borrowed and how you deal with that and how you balance out your priorities, all right? That's when the ratings agencies get involved heavy. That's when the IMF them get involved heavy. And they're looking at your situation. They're going, you still got to make hard choices. Even though people are employed, that's great. Money's flowing into the economy, that's great. You're still going to have to make hard choices. Among them, taxation. Because if the economy comes back, you raise taxes. Right? You're trying to get some of that consumer spend. It's not a straight back of the napkin calculation. There needs to be elasticity in the economy to handle taxation from a certain point. It's regressive taxation. Maybe they'll come up with a progressive tax. We'll see. But you're still going to have a debt problem that's going to last you quite some time, that could be a generational debt problem that's still going to have to make you, still going to have to see you make hard choices, even though the overall economy feels good. You're still going to have to figure out what to do with the debt, the repayment of the debt. If you're restructuring debt, we're still going to have to figure all that out. And along with that, even if the economy opens back up fully, and people are working and the revenue's coming and everything, you're still going to have a debt problem. You're still going to have a debt problem. Now, you may not agree with me, and I'm perfectly willing to hear your logic on why you think it's not going to be a problem, or why you think, or if you think there was a strategy presented. I don't. I didn't see one. Not a serious one. All right? So, and call me. Let me know. And you can text me as well. 323-6232. 3236232. But for certain, we need a Minister of Finance who's taking this very, very seriously on the strategy end. 3236232, 3254316, and 3254259. 3254259. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hello, good afternoon. Are you there?
Hi, good afternoon, Mr. McCartney. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Awesome, man. Not so bad. Listen, Mr. McCartney, I don't think this administration understands how to build an economy, because they're basically handcuffing every citizen in this country outside of a handful of citizens who they choose to empower. Taking case in point, if you're trying to build an economy, shouldn't you be putting monies in the hands of persons who spend that money in the economy rather than persons who's going to be banking and trying to secure their money in some kind of, different bonds and stuff of that nature? The small man in the country is who actually spends the money in the economy. Case in point, the Progressive Liberal Party under the last Christie administration, they leveled the playing field and they made it possible for FNMs, PLPs, DNAs, everybody to have an opportunity to get work. All right? This government is not doing that. They are selectively picking who they want to empower, okay? And they're sending empowerment their way, and that is not rebounding the economy. You understand? Okay, my mouth is still white, Mr. McCartney. I have hundreds of thousands of dollars of equipment that is just sitting. You understand? While they have persons on the side of the road pushing little push lawnmowers and stuff, I have riding lawnmowers, brand new, just sitting on the ground and can't get no work for them. And I think if you're trying to empower people and if you're trying to, you know, build the economy, then you should not be selective in who you give your work to and everything. You should level the playing field and just give persons opportunity to be able to empower them. Okay? And that's my take on that.
Okay. Thank you, man. I appreciate you. Now, I don't agree with all of your points there. Particularly that issuing government bonds isn't the way to go. I don't see any problem with that. Issuing government bonds is a great way for you to build wealth if you can afford it. I do think that they need to find a way to get more small and medium businesses roaring, but that's a function of the broader economy. And I don't know about the PLP affording everyone the chance to work, but I think what you may be referring to is the giving out of contracts. I think that's something. But there's billions of dollars sitting right in banks in the Bahamas that are ripe for utilization of investment, all right? You just had Gawin Bo complaining about them borrowing so heavily in U.S. currency when there's so much liquidity in local banks, all right? So I agree with some of it, but I hear you about the contract thing. This says, okay, I gotta. It says, Juan, you have me scared as hell, but this is what's needed. We need to get woken up as a nation. This is not a playing matter. I honestly feel like planning to bail out of this country. I never knew or understood the trouble we are in. Says, Juan, you're obviously still at your four-year ferry. Ferry what? In my opinion, what? Talk show crusade to discredit the FNM administration. I can only assume in hopes of helping the scandal-riddled PLP former government return to office. However, from what I'm hearing on the ground in the community, the FNM will win again in 2022. I'm sorry, with all due respect, you will lose credibility with your many listeners. Some even refer to you as a fool. But don't give up. Follow your passion. Keep trying, my friend. Okay. You know, I don't know what that does to change anything I've said. You're trying to make an ad hominem attack on me, but you cannot point to anything I have said as being false, and therefore it's a childish, petty argument from clearly someone who lacks the mental rigor or discipline to apply yourself to what is happening here. All right, tell me that I'm lying. You want to call me immature or whatever it is, and I'm trying to help the PLP, no problem. You could say whatever you want. That changes nothing about what I laid out to you as fact. Tell me I'm lying that come 2026, we're not going to have to pay a $250 million portion of the principal on a $750 million loan that this administration entered into with the will of Parliament. Tell me I'm lying. while you're calling me immature, while you're calling me a fool. Tell me your children, if you have children, if you're blessed enough to have children, won't have to be dealing with these issues down the road. You see, you could call me whatever you want. However, that's not going to change the situation we're in. That's not going to change the fact that we're bleeding money. We're taking on serious debt. What you're hearing on the ground about the FNM, I don't care. What you're hearing on the ground about the FNM, I care. That my children will be saddled with this debt that your FNM undertook, some of it without having a choice, some of it they had choices. That's what I care about. So I don't care what you think about me. All right? And I don't care that you think I lose credibility. I'm certified out here. I'm sure you know this. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
How you doing, brother?
I'm great. How are you?
Top shape. Listen. This country, the economy itself, okay, cannot grow. It cannot move if people and create businesses, okay, because the government don't own the people, all right? And this is what one of the things that is wrong in our country. Both parties, okay? Now, a whole lot of people voted for the government were there, and now we all were heartbroken again. Now they're talking TLP, and it's like the covert. If you're not talking what they want you to say about covert, then you're not making much sense. But the truth of the matter is this: I am on record of saying if the government of the Bahamas, the movement government, is going to be serious about taking care of the people, they have to borrow money because that's what happens if you have no other real main of monies coming in. The little tourism was coming in. It's not coming in on a large level like how it was. This government were doing pretty fine in business people mind, all right, before the COVID, all right, and before Dorian. So the COVID and the hurricane and COVID came and complicated some stuff. We comprehend that. In fact, I accept that. But what I cannot, like you said, allow for the debt to continue to climb that my children and our children will have to pay, and then we those of our age bracket who have the knowledge of how to work and make money, what to do, what do you do in a time of a crisis, when a nation is in crisis, what does the people need to know how to do? And the people who knows this information, this is who the government must invest in, all right? Where party is there or who's there now, we will have, like you said, a national debt that is climbing by the seconds, okay? And I am then encouraging the government, the prime minister, the competent authority, to do not get sidetracked with the politics, because it will always be there. You will always have to deal with it until you don't have to deal with it. Just focus on the young people, focus on business-minded people who are willing to go back to work and stop talking nonsense about natural results, because we know what the facts is behind the scene, behind the portrait.
Okay, appreciate you, my brother. It says the PLP is not the answer, and in fact, their wasteful spending habits created a lot of the problems this current government is facing. Oh, boy. I feel sometimes like I'm wasting my time. I'm trying to explain to you what's happening right now. All right? That this doesn't sink in. That it's not about the PLP. That it's about we need an economic strategy that's going to see us through this thing. And it's on the current Minister of Finance to do this. The PLP needs to present a plan. I await their plan. But your fear of the PLP cannot excuse the Minister of Finance's lack of an economic strategy. It cannot. Here's the next thing I want to say. I am alarmed at the level of debt. I am alarmed at the level of borrowing. However, if the economy is growing, then the level of debt to me is secondary. All right? The problem is we're not seeing robust enough economic growth as we pile on this debt. If your economy's firing on all cylinders, if you're getting a solid 3% a year, you're in good shape. You can take on this debt. But that's not the case. We lack the economic growth that's commensurate with how fast we're piling on the debt. While you attack me, you always make it about me, because the guy we're paying to come up with the economic strategy doesn't have one. That's my fault. I'm trying to help the PLP. One day, the next day, I'm trying to help the FNM. You guys sound crazy. What I'm trying to do is tell the truth. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, good afternoon. What are you doing?
Hey, right here. What's happening?
Everything good, man. And good afternoon to the nation. Mm-hmm. Excellent. I agree with all your points. As you know, I've expressed all of those points as well. What I want to add to your conversation, though, is a statement by the central bank governor, right? Which is critical. Uh-huh. He made this statement, I think, on the 15th of 2021, right? The Bahamas suffered a more than $400 million foreign currency shortfall in 2020 that had to be covered by government's overseas borrowing activities, mm-hmm. right? That is critical one. This is on top of the on top of the funds that the government won in that $700 million loan or $750 million loan that was shopped abroad at the expensive rate at the time, right? What the financial secretary and the then minister of finance did not provide for the Bahamian people was their plan for growth and how they were going to address the additional time that they secured when they got that $750 million from the foreign currency, I mean, from the foreign markets to bolster our central bank foreign currency, right? And we still have yet to see, but what we do know is as a result of, as you would have expressed, the COVID-19 governor expressed in a communication in January, we had a $400 million shortfall, right? And so, Warren, I agree with you completely. We are in serious trouble. If you're borrowing $750 million to bolster foreign currency, and on top of that, you have a $400 million shortfall, that's 1.1, right, Warren? And so predominantly, most of the funds that are in the central bank that is bolstering foreign currency is borrowed money. It's borrowed money, Warren.
Yeah, there's no that's question something, about that, yeah.
That's something to be extremely concerned about, because right now, the top provider of foreign currency in our country is tourism. And we don't see where the government of the Bahamas has an aggressive strategic plan in place to grow tourism in our country, but first and foremost, to recover tourism in our country, and then to grow tourism in our country, right? And so, one, if the Minister of Finance, who, in my opinion, he is clearly not competent as the Minister of Finance, if he does not provide a strategic plan of growth for the number one industry that produces the largest amount of foreign currency in our country, we are going to be in serious trouble in this country. And if they do not change, I'll end on this point one, if they do not change their practice of giving to the rich and taxing the poor and middle class, the poor and middle class would be taxed out of everything that they worked hard for over the last 20, 30, 40 years in this country to attain middle class status quo in this country. We need a change in government one. Thank you for the opportunity. Continue the good works, my brother.
Okay. Thanks, Anton. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hello. Good afternoon. Are you there? You might want to turn your radio down.
Hey, how you doing, Art?
Good. How's it going?
Good, man. Good. You know, I listen to the program.
Are you there? You might want to turn your radio down.
Hello?
Yes, turn your radio down for me, please, sir.
Okay. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Yes.
Great. Great. You know, we had a great leader, John F. Kennedy, right?
Mm-hmm.
And John F. Kennedy asked a question. He said, don't ask what your country can do for you, but ask what you could do for your country.
Right.
You know, we've loved Lenin and blah. We're in a very serious position. What is our population like?
Somewhere around
400. Around about 400?
Yes.
Yeah, and out of the 400, we have about 50,000, 60,000 kids.
You probably have about 30% of the population that is under 18, so over 100,000. Yeah.
We have about 300,000. You know,
in terms of what? What do you mean? 300,000 who? Adults? People. In terms of working adults or what?
Adults. Whether they're working or not.
Okay, adults. Sure, go ahead.
Because no matter what it is, everybody can afford something. Even if they're working.
Okay.
And I'm saying what? We're in a very, very serious predicament. All we have to do is every individual, 300,000 individuals, okay, to contribute $1 a day to some kind of fund towards the loan. Man, you know we could pay off this loan in no time. In no time, one. That's $1 a day. $300,000.
Mm-hmm. I tell you what, let me help you with some of this. Let me help you, right? So you're saying $300,000. So let's say $300,000 a day, right?
Yes.
Every day, right?
Right.
That's $109,500,000.
$109,500,000.
Okay. In a year, right? Do you want to know what it would we spend on just to service those loans a year? $1 million.
$300 million to service those
to service those our loans. Debt. Yes, about yeah. $300 million. So yeah. It's going to take more than a dollar a day, is what I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, I understand that. But, you know, I'm just thinking about it, you know. What? Can
I'm glad
we
you're
do?
Thinking. Yeah, I'm glad you're
yeah,
thinking.
Yeah, what can we do for our country?
Ultimately, and here's the thing, ultimately it will be us who pays it back.
It's ultimately.
It's how that happens is the point. All right? But I thank you. At least you're thinking. I like it. But that one's not going to get us. Not going to get us there like that. But you're thinking about it properly. Now, I like where your head's at in terms of having people contribute to set something aside. I think a national savings plan is a good idea, so that people don't find themselves in such a dire situation. Perhaps pension legislation is in order in this country for us to start doing that. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Juan. Thanks for taking my call.
No problem.
Let me start off by saying I think the leader of the opposition, Mr. Davis, need to loose the gag order of these candidates, or if not all, and Chester Cooper out there, say, talk to the media, say whatever you all want to say, I can endorse it. Because Anton should not be the one voice crying out in the wilderness singing the PLP song. I tired of that voice now. Really?
I don't think the gag order is there, but Anton is a frequent caller. I listened to Anton call Dwight's show this morning. I listened to Anton call Levin's show.
Anton calls every show.
I listened to him call
But I'm saying it shouldn't just be his voice.
And I appreciate his calling, but perhaps you have some sort of point. Yes.
And with your presentation today, what it caught you, remember? Something you said about your doctor tell you when you were spoken, you will live, but you were spoken.
Right, exactly.
It's like it's sobering, you know.
Yeah.
Something needs to be done, or something really bad can happen.
Something has to be done, that's right.
And I feel like you just, your presentation just laid out to the country. My concern is the prime minister, as much as I like the man, it's like the job just a little too hard for him. But maybe he trained to fly like a twin engine and we rolling on a jumbo jet. He just ain't trained for this.
Well, you can't do it, right? So understand certain things you can't do. So if the pilot have a heart attack, you can't jump up and be like, I can fly the plane. You don't know how to fly no plane.
Exactly.
Sit down and go find a pilot.
Exactly. You don't know what to do.
Right.
Or if you in the seat. You better call somebody on the ground who could at least, you know,
walk you through it. Yeah, right.
Exactly. But you can't handle it. And the prime minister now saying this co-prime minister thing, right?
Right.
First time I ever hear in the history of this country. And during the last election, he said, I can take the ministry, go around, I can supervise, whatever. Now you don't even want the one job you take?
Right. You can co-prime minister now.
Exactly. You don't want the one job you take. As prime minister, you don't want that no more. You want to be prime minister, but you don't want to do it. Now you can look out in the next
administration for the poor. Well, we was asking for about 4 years now, poor people die.
Right.
Well, obviously it wasn't the poor. I guess this time it can be the poor time.
But listen,
I
don't understand it. It don't make no sense. And you're trying to crack jokes and stuff. Stop it. Like, let's have a strategy. Present that. Let's do that.
Yeah, we can't clown now, man. We're in serious trouble. This calls for serious business. This calls for serious decisions to be made. Keep up the good work, McCartney, man. You're doing a good job.
Thank you, my brother. And the reality is that every portfolio, aside from Attorney General, is his, right? That's, you assign people to overlook things, but ultimately you are responsible, all right? Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Nope. All right. One more call. We'll take a break, and then we'll do our text messages. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, good afternoon.
How's it going?
Everything's good. I have a question I want to ask you.
Mm-hmm.
Is this the best the Ministry of Finance could do? Because I know PN Minister ain't got it. But is this the best retail those permanent secretaries and all those advisors to come up with?
I, you know what? I don't put it on them. I because they're not responsible for policy. They're not responsible for policy. They're technocrats. They put the budget together. They make the numbers work. You say, I want to do X, Y, Z. They go, okay, here's where to do X, Y, Z. They explain to you what your statutory commitments are, et cetera. Like, so I don't put it on them.
Man, somebody should tell them that this ain't gonna work, man.
Yeah, it's him who is responsible for policy.
Boy, because this is clearly a glaring issue. That this can't work.
Yeah, it ain't working like this.
I don't know.
Like, I mean, so I know it's like you search for it. It can be that, but A, it's the Ministry of Finance, people who put the budget together. Now, you could question some of the how they are putting stuff together, because now they have this transfers to NEC thing, which I'll admit I don't understand. I've been told it's where they transfer money to corporations underneath those ministries, but it's a bit too opaque for me. But really, the policy decisions are coming from the minister, and he's enforcing the policy of the cabinet. So I can't blame the technocrats at the Ministry of Finance. Unless something's going on I don't know about. One more call, then a break. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Then we'll get to your text messages. I love how y'all make this about me. I love how it's about me, right? Like, this ain't your country. Like, you don't have to pay these bills back. Like, saying something stupid about me is going to change the situation. It's so glaringly dumb. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hello, Avon.
Hey, how's it going?
Man, I was listening to your radio station, and you make me scared. Like I was getting ready to watch a horror movie.
No, I want you to be sober about it. I want you to understand.
I appreciate that. Now, what I call to say is this. I noticed you said that our service bill alone is $300 million a year.
Yeah, thereabouts, yes.
Why doesn't our country, since we're always borrowing, at some point the people, I assume, won't lend us, why don't we invest in our fisheries on a large scale? Because basically what I understand is we still going to be at war to fight for our own self, to fight for our lives. Mm-hmm. Or our kids can pay back all of these expenses. If we invest in each year a budget to grow fisheries like conch and stuff like that, sell it to the world, export it to Freeport, because we have a hub in the Bahamas that goes out to the world. Hire some of our best cooks and let them taste the conch meat. And places like China and the States, they buy seafood, which is very expensive. All the time, they would buy us out no matter how much we produce.
Yeah, I think, and you make a good point.
Let me say more thing to it. When I did research on it, and when they expand, like have babies, they have 1,000 times more. They produce 1,000 babies a time. So if they're producing this, that would be expanded. And if we have time for them to grow. We have time for them to grow. We have time for us to expand, and we could prepare for this financial crisis we'll be in.
Well, I think that you make a good point about the growing the fisheries. We got to take a break. We have heard Michael Pintard speak repeatedly about turning that our fisheries and agricultural sector into our local fisheries and agricultural sector into $1 billion and plus industry, and I think that's doable in not too long a time. And so that's one of the things you got to be looking at, right? Let's take a break. We'll be back on the other side.
In life, there are always challenges. Today, we find ourselves having to be more self-sufficient, socially aware, and technically savvy. At J.S. Johnson, we are committed to our customers by providing cost-effective insurance solutions. No matter what your insurance needs, we will always be here for you. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com. J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers, giving you peace of mind.
Tired of disposable plates that fall apart and leave the food in your lap? Neptune Compostables can solve your problem. Put your food in our heavy-duty clamshells.
At Neptune, we supply heavy-duty take-out plates, coffee cups, sauce cups, soup bowls, straws, and plastic-free take-out bags. We offer free delivery to offices, takeaways, restaurants, bars, and households.
And we ship to the family islands.
Order now via WhatsApp at 816-2442. That's 816-2442. Or shop online at NeptuneCompostables.com.
Neptune, where your sense makes sense.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Looking for plenty food and you're on a budget?
Well, yeah, great.
Stop into Wendy's and grab our latest bundle. Introducing the Biggie Bag. With the new Biggie Bag, you get a Dave Singles, Junior Fries, regular drink, and four-piece nuggets for only $7.25, fat inclusive. Add an apple pie for just $1 more. Now that's a deal.
Motor, also hook up, eh?
It's the best on these streets. Available at all locations. Restrictions apply. Wendy's, different inside and out.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. We got time for one more call. Lots of your text messages. Let's read them. I love how some of you are so unfocused. I don't love it, actually. I hate it. It's frightening on many levels. Good afternoon. Welcome to The Revolution.
Good afternoon, Warren.
How's it going?
Well, I'm the opinion Obama must have been working on us. But the PLP be doing mess. The F of them talking and doing mess. See, this is what you get when you hire somebody without having them vetted. Papa picked him to be the leader, but we have a chance to moderate him. Because you should be the next public debate. I want you to be the one of the wanting them to vet these people. Ask them questions like that about high finance. We have a doctor, so he will run. He will be CEO of the hospital. That's impossible. But we have a doctor who will run this country, and he could duck and dodge. But we were warned from the seven MPs. That was a hard choice, Nico Grant.
Okay. Thanks, my brother. I got to move on to my text here. This says, good afternoon. The unions or government executives will not give up any benefits. You're wasting your time. It says is. It says, why don't you just come out and say you're campaigning for your boy, Chester Cooper? We could see where your heart lies. I mean, you guys are so ridiculous. Like, it's, do you understand where we are? Like, do you understand the depth of this situation? You're here talking about campaigning for the PLP, and now are you guys this unfocused in your real lives? Like, when you're confronted with a situation as dire as this? This is how you react? You guys are just silly. Silly, I'm trying to explain to you that we are in peril. Deep, deep peril, and we are not in a place where we can afford the luxury of having a minister of finance who's out of his depth to this point. All right? And you could say whatever you like about me. It changes nothing about this situation. Instead of attacking me, why don't you show me where the fiscal strategy was? Instead of your silliness, since you so love your F&M, why don't you explain to me what they pointed to that will bring us out of this situation? You guys are ridiculous. I feel sorry for you, actually, that this is... that you obscure facts in order to comfort yourself that your party has things under control. It speaks to a pathology, if you will, and I feel badly for you. And this guy always texts about the FNM. I know your number. I have it saved. And you always text about the FNM in support of anything the FNM does. And now your line of attack is to clearly say that I'm trying to help the PLP, when just yesterday I had the daughter of the former prime minister, of the late prime minister, on talking about dysfunction within the PLP. You really don't think these things through. And I'm actually sorry I've dedicated so much time responding to your BS. Good afternoon, Juan. I wholeheartedly agree with your serious sentiments with regard to the negative state of our economy and the urgency to find an immediate solution to our dilemma. This says, I want it so important that matters you are discussing are taken seriously, like so many other issues in the Bahamas that most Bahamians can't comprehend. It's good to have you tell it like it is. How can the PM address a situation if he can't take it seriously? He's lost. He's lost. That's what it is, right? The PLP notwithstanding, he appears lost. Hi, Juan. It's interesting how the PM was talking what he's going to do in his next term, but he has over a year before elections in 2022. Oh, wait, elections soon reach, no matter what he says. He says, hey, Juan, don't mess with the juicing now. Oh, the juicing show. What's that show name, the juicing all the time one? That on Netflix or Fire? It's on Netflix. Bridgerton. Bridgerton is the name of the show. Juan, you're correct on the state of our nation. Also, the conversation of permanent and pensionable is something most don't want to hear. The marches and strikes will begin. Juan, we were warned from LBT about Minister's leadership style and laziness. Now he's talking about co-PM, trying to duck real hard work, so he'll be getting half pay then. Juan, somebody around here got to be doing OBA in the PLP too. There's too much confusion. This is why we need to get rid of them, both the PLP and the FNM. This is why I found my AirPods in a pizza box with some leftover pizza sitting in my fridge. You check your fridge? No, I found that. I found them. It says, as an FNM supporter, I believe you are not biased and often provide good critique. I don't always agree with you, but you are fair. It says, governments are continuous while administrations have a limited life, which is typically 5 years. The development and strengthening of our marine economy has actually been done by the PLP and the FNM over the last 15 years. Go figure, they're working together. It says, A1, people care more about their party's reputation than the truth and the financial future of the country. Fact is, if we had the ingenuity and will of the Chinese people, fishing would be the number one industry in the country. I won. Your show today is very interesting. My family and I would just like to say a special thank you to you for explaining the budget to us. This show and yesterday's show with Monty Pindling should be repeated in your absence. Thanks. It says, sir, the Prime Minister spoke of co-Prime Ministers because that job is out of his league. He really needs help. It says, always love your show, McCartney. Don't be discouraged. You're getting through to tons of Bahamian citizens and residents listening to your radio show daily. Don't throw in the towel. Don't be discouraged. Stay strong. Ignore those colorblind, deranged, diehard FNM and diehard PLP buffoons. Keep being your usual fair and balanced, unbiased self. By the way, speaking about the Minister of Finance, why isn't he and the Minister of Foreign Affairs seemingly not addressing the upcoming blacklisting from the Europeans? McCartney, you need to talk about that one day. Yeah, we did. I did ask Ellsworth Johnson when he was here about that, and he didn't really give me a clear answer on what the actual strategy is. It says, what are they doing with our money? It's poor leadership. It says, legalize marijuana and be a producer who could export at the cheapest rate before other Caribbean islands. Do it, then use the taxes to pay off all national debt only. It says, a dollar a day, pay your bills. Some of these people have the money, big money, to pay their real property tax, but just refuse to pay. All parties just blow hot air to say they'll deal with real property tax, and they fumble the ball. It says, tell Anton that this erosion of the middle class all started, continued in the last administration. The dilemma we're in is that the economy of the Bahamas and the leadership of Dr. Menendez is being managed poorly, but I don't see where Philip Brave Davis-led PLP government will get us out of this mess we are in. Herein lies our country's dilemma. And I have not heard any strategy by the PLP yet that's going to get us, that could get us out of this. I want, it's a matter of trust for government, but the people don't trust the leaders now. The more money they collect, the more they'll mess up. That's why people don't want more taxes, because we don't get a proper return. Thanks. That's a big reason why I don't want more taxes. Yes, I don't believe it. They're done. I don't believe they are utilized to their proper capacity. Boy, one great show, and well done to Amos. Most coherent thing I've ever heard out of him. On the topic, though, we need to borrow with the strategy of capital expenditure and expanding infrastructure on the family islands to create more communities. More communities should create growth by having businesses expand to other islands and then expand to the tax base. This is how I think we can get ahead. Thanks. And you know what? I've been, and I know we only have a little bit of time left, and I'm gonna read the rest of your text message, and maybe we can get back to this tomorrow. I've been trying to turn over in my mind, because we have so much land. Nassau is one of the small, New Providence is one of the smallest islands in the archipelago, right? We have so much land that we could do so much with, that could hold so much, so many more people, and really get the economy humming where you have options. You know what I mean? So if there's an option, and Nassau's full of crime, and y'all can't drive worth a damn, and I want to say, I want to go back to Eleuthera, back to my hometown. Like, but is there an economy there to sustain us? So what comes first, the chicken or the egg, right? The people or the economy, right? Usually it's the people, and people are there, and they start off small. You start off with farming, then you go manufacturing, then you go through other, you know what I mean? So I'm really trying to figure that out. Like, how do we get these economies going on the family islands so that we really do have options, that we could see growth, independent growth? Because any family island, listen carefully to me now, any family island in the Bahamas can be a Turks and Caicos. Yes, we have a better economy than them, but they're doing pretty good. Every family island, and it doesn't have to be Turks and Caicos, but Turks and Caicos was just another few islands in the chain. But you give them the capacity to do their own thing, and it grows, right? Some missteps along the way. The British still got them, you know, but still, it grows. And I'm really trying to figure out that equation. Like, how do we do that? I think that's one of the keys. Good afternoon, Juan. That idiot from the D generation saying you're siding with a party is lost. Those are facts you revealed. Even the campaign workers don't discuss the facts with voters. They sweeten them up with promises that are not kept. Well, here's what that is. When you feel someone is a threat, right? I hold no power other than being in front of this microphone. When you feel someone is a threat to your party, and you don't have the capacity to defend the facts, you try to smear that person. And that's happened, and I have no brief for the PLP. They tried to destroy me before the last election. All right? But I'm not going to sit here and excuse poor performance because you fear this looming specter of a PLP administration. I'll deal with that when it comes, if it comes. But I'm dealing with what's right in front of me right now in terms of the fiscal strategy and the mid-year budget. It says, I'm not voting PLP anymore because of Anton. And a lot of people won't vote PLP, and that's fine. That's fine. You deal with what it is you're dealing with, but don't discount the fact of where we are. It says, one, I support the PLP, and I hate to hear Anton's voice. The cost of living in this country is already too high, and we're getting more taxes. One, whatever party's elected, they can no longer tax the poor. Question how much tax is too much tax, because the middle-class citizens of the Bahamas are going extinct. One, when last you felt like an upper-middle-class citizen, because I haven't felt like that since 1999. I wouldn't say I feel upper-middle-class, although I probably would be classified as upper-middle-class in my household because of my wife's salary and mine. But I don't feel upper-middle-class. I feel as though I am. I don't feel under any sort of duress at the moment, but I feel like I am in a constant battle to build something for the next generation because I don't want to leave them starting from scratch. And so I feel a constant level of pressure, and I feel though it's a Herculean task that I've made it my mission to undertake so that my children don't have to start from scratch and that we can build some generational wealth. This says, I agree with you on wholeheartedly. If tourists come, the debt is still going to be there. Don't need you bamming on desk. I need to hear real plans to fix it. It says, if everything goes back to normal, these politicians will continue to waste taxpayers' money. It's only going downhill going forward. And it says, bro, you're late to the party. I saw this from 1989. Get the firewood, plant food in your yard. It's much worse than you think. It says, one, listening to the doctors about COVID statistics is no different from listening to their advice on auto mechanics. Our people don't understand math. Says, Mr. McCartney, your expectation of Dr. Minnis is too high. It says, is Dr. Minnis able to manage anything? He came in saying he's not taking a portfolio because he needs to concentrate on being CEO. Now he's saying he's going to give Bannister some of his CEO responsibilities. What is that? I don't know. I don't understand what's happening. I really wish that we would take this all much more seriously. I'm all for having fun as much as the next guy, but I really do wish that we take this more seriously beyond just this party thing, that if there's poor performance, if there's lack of a proper strategy, that we can call that for what it is and say, we need to do better. We have to stop enabling mediocrity. You want to attack me? That's fine. Say whatever you like. The public knows that I'm fair and I call it as I see it. But if this radio show stops tomorrow, we're still going to have the same set of circumstances that we're in. And we're still going to need to address it with sense. You guys take care out there. Have a great day, Bahamas.